Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ba'd. Allahumma la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal alimul hakim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. We will not do any revision. We'll go right to the next chapter, which is Salat al-Jamaa. We were speaking about Salat al-Jamaa, but we had started Shurut al-Jamaa, Shurut al-Imam, the conditions for the Imam. Who should the Imam be? And before we start that, we have one revision. And whoever was here last week, we spoke about one hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is قال صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أم القوم أكثرهم أقرأهم يا أم القوم أقرأهم بكتاب الله فإن كانوا في القراءة سواء فأعلمهم بالسنة فإن كانوا بالسنة سواء أقدمهم في روايات. There's many روايات. The next one would be فأقدمهم هجرة فإن كانوا في الهجرة سواء فأقدمهم سلما وفي رواية فأكبرهم سنا. And he also says ولا يؤم الرجل الرجل في سلطانه ولا يجلس في بيته على تكريمته إلا بإذنه. This is a long hadith. The hadith means that no one, that one, the most knowledgeable of the Quran should lead you. يأم القومة. The group should be led by the one who is most knowledgeable in the Quran. And if they're equal in the Quran, then they should be the one who is the most knowledgeable in the Sunnah. And if it's if they're equal in the Sunnah, then it should be the one who is the oldest in the Hijrah, in the days of the Prophet ﷺ. Whoever has made Hijrah first is the most entitled to lead in Jama'ah. And if they're equal in that, then the one who is the oldest in Islam, who has become a Muslim first, and if they and then the other riwayah narration is the one who is oldest, akbaruhum sinnan. And in the same hadith, this is the one that includes the most conditions, and it's sahih, is the man should not lead another one in his sultan, in his bait, in his house, or the Imam al-Ratib, that's his sultan. No one should impose himself to lead, whereas there is an Imam al-Ratib. Nor should someone sit in someone's home without his permission. So one should be careful in allowing the host to show you where to sit. Maybe you're gonna sit where he sits. That's his takrima. He has a special place. You should not sit anywhere until he tells you where to sit. This is this hadith. So we mentioned three opinions about this hadith. Who is entitled to imama? لا يأم القوم يأم القوم أقرأهم بكتاب الله. Can anyone remember the three opinions? Absolutely, the one who knows the most Quran. And there's a hadith I summarized the dalail, the proofs. لِيَأُمَّنَّ أَكْثَرُكُمْ قُرْآنًا. The one who knows the most Quran should lead you. What's the second, their opinion?
Riwayat.
Very nice. أَكْثَرُكُمْ أَوْ أَحْسَنُكُمْ قِرَاءَةً, which means the one who is the most knowledgeable in the riwayat al-mutawatira, which is the 10 riwayat. So anyone who perfections or the most capable of reading one of the riwayat is the one that should read you. So not beautiful voice, that's just istihsan, that's just mustahab. A beautiful voice is good. But the one who is most knowledgeable in the qira'at. And the third one, mashallah, doing well. The most knowledgeable, na'am. Afqahukum, al-afqah. And this is the opinion of the jumhur, of the Malikiyya and the Shafi'iyya. The Shafi'iyya and the Malikiyya, they say, أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِأَحْكَامِ الصَّلَةِ. The one who is the most knowledgeable about Salah, first of all, but in general, the Sharia. So this is very quick. This is the quickest we can go through. But let's start the Shurut al-Imama. شروط الإمامة تسعة. Again, we have to focus on the Malikiya. I have not reviewed the other schools. Unless I remember something, I will share it with you. Because there are a lot of differences of opinion, even in these small details. But in the first shart, the first condition, there's no difference of opinion. The first condition is that the imam must be a Muslim. End of story. Even if you find out later that he's not a Muslim, you have to repeat your salah. You can say, I didn't know he was not a Muslim. My salah is my salah. If you realize that he was not a Muslim after you're done, 2 years later, you have to repeat that salah. Absolutely. Your imamah has to be a Muslim. And here we're speaking about shurut. And every time we speak about any ibadah, we have three levels of shurut. Shurutu siha, shurutu wujub, or shurutu siha wa wujub. Every time we speak about any ibadah, we have conditions. If these conditions are fulfilled, first, it is valid. Another set of conditions, if they're fulfilled, it is wajib to do that ibadah. Another set of conditions, if they are fulfilled, it's not only valid, but it is wajib. So here it's just shurut usihha. It's only the shurut of validity. So the second condition of validity is we have to know that the imam is a male. It's funny, but I think it's funny. He must be male, and his malehood must be certain, because you know, when we speak about hish, you know, someone who doesn't know, he doesn't know whether he's a he or he's a she, or we don't know whether he's a he or he's a she. This is not new. Homosexuality is not new. This was known way in the beginning. So the person has to be a true male. He cannot have two male organs. Some people have two male organs, mukhannath or mushkal, someone who is effeminate or someone who is not sure what he is. He may have a stronger male organ than a female, or vice versa. فلا تصح الصلاة خلف امرأة. In all the schools, it is not valid to pray behind a woman. And we're talking about, there's no khilaf here. There's no differences of opinion for the maktuba. For the other stuff, there's a lot of talk. We'll speak there, we'll get there. So he's asking, what about a child who has not reached puberty? We'll get there in a minute. So this person who is not certain, we're not certain of his malehood, he cannot even lead others like him. So this is the validity of being an imam, he must be male. وَالْعَقْلُ, and someone has to be in his full mental capacity. Some people have this is a temporary or lapses of their mental state. They cannot lead salah in that state. But if they come back and forth, if they are in their proper mental state, they can lead in that proper mental state. وَغَيْرُ مَأْمُومًا, this is very specific to the Malikiyya and the Hanafiyya. I know that in the Shafi'iyya it is permissible, and I know that in one of the opinions of the Hanabila it is permissible, because I've heard it from some of the scholars in their fatwa, and that is غَيْرُ مَأْمُومًا. So someone is ma'mum, there's an imam here, and everyone is praying, or he's a masbuq, ma'mum or masbuq. The imam is done, someone comes in, and he stands beside the one who was behind the imam, and he prays with him. You understand what I'm saying? So someone who is ma'mum, someone who is being led by an imam, or his masbuq, he came late, and he's being led by the imam, and the imam is finished, and someone came from the outside and he joins that person who was ma'mum, who was being led. In the Maliki, it is not a valid imama. In the Maliki. And I've heard many scholars, some of my teachers in Medina, they accept that. They said, labas. They say, labas abihi. So if you want to be strict with the madhab, the Hanafi and the Maliki, someone who is ma'mum or masbuq, is not, it is not permissible for him. He, your following him is not valid. He's not an imam. When I am ma'moom and someone joins me, I don't tell him to move, because it may be his opinion. It may be his school. So I continue without the intention of being an imam, but he is, for him, it's okay. So these are two opinions, and they're all based on valid schools. So let me go through this very specific point and go through the details, because it has to do with al-istikhlaf. In the future, we will speak about al-istikhlaf. If the imam remembers that he does not have wudu, he leaves and he brings someone else to lead his salah. That is called istikhlaf. So he puts someone in his place. So I'm going to go through this very in details. So he says, غير مأموم فلا تصح خلف مأموم ولا مسبوق قام لقضاء ما عليه فاقتدى به غيره. Oh, that's what I just explained. ولو لم يعلم بأن إمامه مأموم إلا بعد الفراغ من صلاته. So this person in the Maliki, of course, right? So that's this person stood beside him, and when he was done, he said, "Listen, I was ma'mum as well." So he has to repeat his salah. Is that clear? Okay. And then, غير متعمد حدث فلا تصح خلفه وإن لم يعلم المأموم بذلك إلا بعد الفراغ من الصلاة. So the imam, he does not have wudu, but he is not aware of it. As long as it does not tell you, as long as he does not remember, if he doubts and he's leading the salah, he does not stop salah. Okay, so someone, he's sure that does not have wudu, he must stop salah. وَلَا يَعْمَلْ. As soon as he remembers, he should not move forward. لَا يَعْمَلْ بِالْمَأْمُومِ فِي الصَّلَةِ. That means as soon as he remembers that he does not have wudu, he's in ruku', should not stand up. He should stay in ruku' and bring someone in the ruku', in the state of ruku', to do istikhlaf. He's in sujood, he should not sit and say Allahu Akbar. He should get up, of course, but without telling others that this is the next movement. So لا يعمل. But if he's in doubt whether he has tahara or not, he has to continue his salah. Is this clear? So someone is leading salah, but now he has a doubt. He should continue his salah until he is sure. If he's not sure until he is done, he should not tell anyone. But if he knows after he has left, he really remembered, "Naam, I did not have my wudu." The people behind him, their salah is correct. But for him, he has to repeat it, because now he knows that his salah was not valid. But if he tells them right away, he turns around, "You know what, I didn't have, this is very difficult. This is the touchy point. This is very, very difficult." He turns around and there's about 3,000 people, "I didn't have my wudu." It's very, very, I won't answer the question for that one. والقدرة على الأركان. I've summarized the istikhlaf. والقدرة على الأركان. And someone who leads should be capable to do all the pillars properly. For instance, he has reading al-Fatiha with the voice, so he cannot be mute. How do you call that? Someone doesn't speak. Dumb. Someone who's dumb cannot lead others who can speak, unless they're dumb like him. Someone who cannot stand, he can only sit. Or someone who cannot do ruku', he has to do it while sitting. That person, in the Maliki only, because there are differences of opinion. I believe it's in the Hanbali, where the person who is sitting can lead the one who is standing. So there are differences of opinion. But in the Maliki, the person who is leading must be perfectly capable to fulfill all the pillars. The standing position, the ruku', they must be perfect. He must be able to speak. Okay, he must be able to do all of those things. So al-qudratu ala al-arkan. فَإِنْ عَجَزَ عَنْ رُكْنٍ مِنَ الْأَرْكَانِ فَلَا تَصِحُ الصَّلَاةُ خلفه إلا إذا سواهم مأموم. Unless his salah will be acceptable if those behind him have the same hindrance.
This rule applies to everything.
Yes, yes, yeah, exactly. I don't know if it's Jumhur, but there is a difference of opinion. Yeah, absolutely. But I don't know if it's Jumhur. The seventh one, العلم بما تصح به الصلاة من الأحكام كالشروط والأركان. The imam has to be knowledgeable. This is taken from this hadith. يا أم القوم أقرأهم بكتاب الله. So he has to be knowledgeable. So now this is perfectly a Maliki condition, and it's also in the other schools. The imam has to be knowledgeable about the arkan. How many arkan? 15 pillars. He has to know them. Even if he does not differentiate between a pillar and a sunnah. Unless he confuses one pillar with a sunnah. In other words, it's better to know the difference between the pillar and the sunnah. So whenever I quote this condition, I say the person who knows the difference between a pillar and a sunnah. So ruku' is a pillar, okay? At-tahiyya.
First one.
At-tahiyya. This is testing everybody. Test 1, 2, 3. Masha'Allah alik. Allah harda alik. In the Shafi'iyya, التشهد الأول والثاني is both a pillar. In the Malikiyya, it is not, it's Sunnah. Okay? In fact, in the Shafi'iyya, in the second one, when you do a Salat ala Nabi, it's not just a Salat ala Nabi, it's the Salah on the family as well. All of it is a pillar. This is العلم بما تصح به الصلاة من الأحكام. وتصح الصلاة باللحن في القراءة ولو في الفاتحة. Okay, so if someone reads الفاتحة ولا الظالين, is this acceptable? What if he reads ولا الدالين? This is لحن. It's beyond him. Is it acceptable for an imam to do that? Imam Abu Hanifa has a very interesting ruling. He says, if the salah is permissible for you, it's permissible for those that are behind you. So if you cannot control a letter, it's out of your control, it is permissible. وَلَوْ بِلَحْنٍ. So even imam can have that problem in pronunciation. أَصْحَابِ الْأُكْدُودِ, doesn't matter. He cannot, sometimes he says it, sometimes he doesn't say it. So it's out of his control unless he does it purposefully, then his salah is batil. If someone purposefully changes one letter in the Quran in his salah, then the salah is batil. Especially if he changes that letter in the Fatiha, because the rest is a sunnah, so it doesn't invalidate. والبلوغ, again, here's differences of opinion. I'm mentioning only the Maliki opinion. The one who leads as-salah al-maktuba has to be puber. The one who leads a nafila can be a child, can be 6-year-old, 7-year-old. As soon as he reaches the distinction between right and wrong, and if he memorizes Quran by the age of 8, he can lead tarawih. There is no problem with that. And this is agreed upon.
That was my question. My question is, you're talking about the women leading salah.
Yeah.
I'm saying, is it permissible for women to lead the salah with a boy male, like not talib?
Yes, yes, that's where there's the differences of opinion. That's why I didn't say this is in the nafila, but it's in the nafila. There are hadith, na'am, of course. There is a hadith about women leading male members of the household if they are not puber, and even the slave on those days. So there are differences of opinion in the nafila. Yeah, and even in her household. So Allahu alam, I don't want to get into that. فلا والبلوغ وهما as for the جمعة, This is very, very popular. It's mashhur. It's mashhur. It's like this is the main opinion in the Maliki that on Jumu'ah he must be resident and he should not be a slave. He's a free person. Because the imama is the status of perfection. It's a level of kamal. So someone who is a slave, it's not that he's not good or a lesser of a person, but his status is not a status of a free person. And this is not an issue anymore because we don't have that, inshallah. We'll never have that again. But he has to be a resident. He has to be a resident, even if it's the minimum. We'll speak about Salatul Safar, a traveler. If someone is traveling, but he's staying here for more than 4 days, he's not a resident. When we go to the IRS conference, for instance, there are some guests that lead Salah, and they're there for more than 4 days. So they're, of course, there's differences of opinion, but in the Maliki, he must be a resident and he must be free. والثامن والتاسع, this was it, and so we're done. Now we have makruhat al-jama'ah. Let me see how much it is for me. I don't want to make it more than 25 or so. Yeah, there is differences of opinion. There's differences of opinion. But in the Maliki, it's... so the reason why you may find a hadith that are not in concurrence with the popular opinion of one madhab, or most of the madhab, is many. And this has to do in the usul. So you may have a hadith which says that, but there is madhab al-tarjih, ومذهب الجمع ومذهب النسخ ومذهب التفويض. These are four very popular schools when you apply the proofs from the hadith. So madhab al-tarjih, for instance, is if you say this hadith comes later, or it is more strong. So if it comes later, I can say that this is madhab al-nasakh. If it comes later, my tarjih is that not invalidates, but it comes after. And if it is tarjih, it's the same. Either it's nasakh, or it has to do with something that is no longer there, even though they're both very strong. Madhab al-jam' is if one hadith does not negate the other one, you have to find a way to bring them together. Okay? At-tafwid, if you have no idea, so you leave it up to Allah, khalas, it's beyond your understanding. We know that the words of the Prophet ﷺ and his actions is a revelation. So we take them as is and we move on. So these are the differences, that's why we have the differences of opinion, but that's a different topic altogether. Next subtopic, maybe do it in 5 minutes, inshallah, and it is the makruhat of Salat al-Jama'ah, the things which are not desired. Imamat al-fasiq bijarihatin walau limithlihi. Someone who is fasiq, an imam who is fasiq. What is fisq? Fisq. There's a lot of definitions of fisq. Fisq could be even the smallest sin, but usually it's for the major sins. So someone who commits a major sin, then it is haram to pray behind him. But if he does a lot of these minor sins, he is known to be a bad person, then it is makruh. In fact, if when we say makruh in the Malikiya, you should try and repeat your salah within the time. If you don't repeat it, it's accepted. In the other schools, they make other conditions, and they call it makruh as well. If the person has a problem with his aqidah, if he's we have problems in our schools. Like someone is maturidi, I'm not praying behind him. Someone is ash'ari, someone is this. So this should not be an issue. They're Muslims.
But there's some of the Qaqidahs that take both of this down.
No.
Wouldn't that go back to the first point that the person has to be Muslim?
Unless it's kufr sarih, sarih. We cannot say that the person, and I say bid'ah, when I say something which is bid'ah, this is a very sensitive issue. But it's if he is within Ahlul Sunnah, then we don't raise that issue. If that person is appointed by the Khalifa, the authority of the land, okay, which shows you how the fuqaha respected the authorities of the land, even if they were against them, if they didn't believe in their manhaj, they have to pray behind him. You pray behind him. Even, no, we are not in Islamic state. Yeah, in not khilafa, in a Muslim land. In a Muslim land, you go to Morocco, you pray in the in that mosque which is on the sea. It's a beautiful masjid, and you don't like the king of Morocco. If you don't like him, don't speak to me. Just kidding. So let's say you don't like the current administration or authorities of the land. You pray, because they're the ones who appointed the imam. So you pray behind him. Anyways, فَاسِقٌ بِالْجَرِيحَةِ فَاسِقٌ بِالْجَارِحَةِ Someone who is fasiq with his hands. It's clear, he drinks, or he fornicates, or he steals, or he cheats, he's known to do that, then it is makruh. وَإِمَامٌ أَعْرَابِيٌ A Bedouin. What is meant by أَعْرَابِي is someone who comes from the outside. وَهُوَ مَجْهُولُ الْحَلْ We don't know who he is. It's makruh. I don't know who he is. It's makruh. That's why it's makruh. It's not an obligation to pray in Jamaa when you are in the Masajid Turuqat. We spoke about this last week. You travel, and on the way to another city, you stop and you pray in that masjid, and there's different jama'at. You are not obliged to pray with the jama'a which is there, because that is not the Imam al-Ratib. And you don't know who's leading that. Huwa majhulul hal. So this is the reason. Imam al-Arabi, Imamatul Arabi, wa Imamatu dhu salisin wa quruhin nis-sahih. And the one who has problems with his urine, he doesn't have problems all the time. Like he has, in the morning, he has a problem. Or in the evening, he has a problem. Otherwise, he doesn't have a problem. So that he has a salas. Okay? It's makruh to pray behind him because we don't know. He knows, we don't know. And also, the quruh, that the quruh, someone who has skin problems, but a very serious case of skin, it's very dry and it bleeds and it has pus and all that. So, no quruh, leprosy? It's a very serious case of skin problem. That person, there's a difference of opinion even in the Maliki, but the sahih is that it is makruh. And I think we'll stop here, even though we didn't finish the chapter. So inshallah, I'll stop here. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi. Barakallahu fikum for your attendance. اللهم زدنا علما اللهم زدنا علما اللهم وانفعنا به اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا اللهم اغفر لنا ولمشايخنا اللهم وأحبنا اللهم واجعل لنا حبا اللهم اجعلنا حبا للعلم وللعلماء وللنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وللتابعين وللصحابة وللتابعين ولأهل البيت اللهم آمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وصحبه